sentence, I should say, on behalf of Nalsar, we welcome Mr. Yogendra Yadav. We started this policy lecture series a year and a half ago, and this is actually now the 11th talk. So when we were starting it, we didn't think that we would actually get such a huge engagement and turnout, but it is proving to be very good. Mr. Yadav doesn't need much of a formal introduction. I can literally say that many of us have grown up watching him analyze elections on television. For many of us, of course, in the last 5 years, he became one of the faces of the movement against corruption. But despite all of that which has happened in the previous few years, he is one of the few public voices which is warning us about the dangers of a personality cult, right? And you know that personality cults can be harmful at all levels, right? So I won't stand between you and the audience, between you and him, and Professor Mr. Yogendra Yadav will possibly speak for about 40 odd minutes. We'll take some questions and answers after that, and we might have some time for informal conversation after that as well, right? So over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for this lovely and mercifully brief introduction. The Indian custom is to say the speaker needs no introduction. And as they say in nice Urdu, hamare aaj ke speaker kisi introduction ke mohtaaj nahi hai. And then go on to say exactly that for 10 minutes to read out the bio data. So thank you for not doing that, and thanks for this wonderful opportunity to come here and to be able to speak. This has been a long-standing commitment which I was unable to fulfill for almost a year now, and thanks for persisting and this opportunity to be here. I'll come straight to the topic. The title that I suggested was India at the Crossroads. The metaphor of crossroad is the metaphor of reaching a point in a journey where we face some confusion, where we have more than one choice, where we don't quite know which way to turn. The metaphor must have originated in Europe. And the lovely thing about European crossroads, as I discovered when I got to travel there, is that every house on the corner of a street carries the name of a street. So it's a crossroads which is marked, where you know what it means to, where left would take you, where right would take you. The beauty about Indian crossroads, as all of us know, is that nothing is marked, that everything is open-ended. And in the last instance, you have to rely upon someone. You have to call someone, "Are bhai saab, oh bhaiya, where are we headed?" And depending on what kind of a person we meet, he could send you exactly in the opposite direction of where you want to go, absolutely confidently and with complete sincerity, you know. Or he or she could say to you, as they say in Bihar, "Haan, bagali mein hai." And that bagal could extend to 20 kilometers, you keep driving and that bagal hasn't arrived yet. This is our typical Indian crossroads. I suspect we are on one of those Indian crossroads where we stop, we suddenly see a little papu sitting somewhere with a puncture shop. We try and call him, and the fellow has, he's completely no idea what the question is, let alone what the answer could be. And as we are speaking to that papu and discovering that he doesn't quite know anything, this confident man walks in and tells you, even before you've asked the question, he's given you the answer. and you are taking a road which is exactly the opposite of the road that you should have taken. This is our contemporary dilemma in India, which we need to resolve, which we need to respond to. That's why India at crossroads. In what I wish to say today, I'll say something about how did we reach where we have reached? Why did we land here? Where do we go? And how exactly do we go where we wish to go? These are very broad topics. And I thought, now that I have this opportunity to speak to all of you at Nalsar, I resisted the temptation of speaking on something technical and thought I would use the opportunity to think collectively about something broad and general. I would be very happy to answer anything very narrow, specific and technical in the Q&A, but allow me to float on this very general sphere for some time. The question is, how did we land where we've landed as a country? The first thing that we need to note is that it's a rather surprising moment for us to land where we've landed. If someone were to chart the journey of India, the second decade of the 21st century is the most unlikely of the periods to bring us to this kind of a situation. It is unlikely for many reasons. In sheer economic terms, we are not in one of our worst economic crises. Usually, lots of people say that countries run into bad weather when they face deep economic crisis. India in 2010 is not facing some of its deepest economic crisis. Economically, sheer looking at it from outside, we are probably doing much better than India used to do. So just when we economically had some more capacity, more resources, had higher growth rate, this is when we end up in the kind of situation that we do. Just when we could afford to do a few things, this is where our political will to do something for the rest of the society suddenly shrinks. In terms of external security, this is one decade when India faces almost zero external threat. We are not living in 1960s, we are not living in 1970s. Whatever challenges you might face, but anyone with some sense of overall global strategic affairs would say India faces very few external threats right now. And this is precisely the moment when national anxieties about security are suddenly heightened in a way which is very odd. You know, clearly there's nothing in the external world that would explain why this is happening. In democratic institutional terms, there was a period in the 1950s, 60s when India wasn't sure of its democratic setup. There was a time in 1970s when democracy came under serious challenge. There was a period in 80s and 90s when we were recovering. Again, 2010s should not be the period in our history when we have to ask questions about what's happening to our democracy. This was just the period when at least that basic electoral routine of a country, that is to say, after every 5 years, elections are held, the party that is elected by the people comes to power, others are thrown out, all that is now taken for granted. So just when India could take its electoral democratic routine for granted, this is where we run into a serious crisis of democratic legitimacy. The point I'm making is very simple. that we have suddenly run into rough weather at a moment which was least expected, which is surprising. The question then is, what explained this? Why is it that we are in this kind of a situation? It is almost as if, one more thing that I forgot to mention is that just when media expands in this country in a way which is unprecedented, and I'm speaking not merely of electronic media, I'm not just speaking about television, it's also the print media. Unlike rest of the world, unlike Europe, unlike Western democracies, our print media is actually expanding like nowhere else in the world. So just when media has expanded in this country, just when we have wider and more powerful media than ever before, suddenly independence of media faces a big question mark. Now, in a sense, what's happening is that some of the institutions, so this surprising crisis, this sense of being ambushed just when we did not think we would be, has to do with something far more deep, something much more fundamental. What is that fundamental thing? I have argued that two sources of constitution of modern India have suddenly come under challenge and threat. Suddenly, two streams that have nourished and constituted contemporary India have dried up. What are those two streams? One is a stream of ideas, the other is a stream of action. Modern India has been constituted by politics. And the one thing that would strike you is that in the West, most of the great thinkers of the West are products of academia. And if you look at India, most of our great thinkers are product of politics. Only one or two great Western thinkers actually had much of a brush with politics. Marx had a very casual sort of, not casual, but that's a tangential brush with politics. Someone like Locke would be at the margins of politics. But you know, these great Western thinkers were largely a product of academia. And in our country, what you can say about academia, and of course Nalsar is an exception to what I'm going to say, is that our academia has very little to do with knowledge. They do lots of things. They do examinations, they give degrees, they do all kinds of things. Knowledge is something that they have very little to do with. Production of original ideas is something which has happened largely in the sphere of politics. That's why modern India is very much politically shaped. And the two things that shaped modern India, one, a tradition of thinking, and second, a tradition of political practice. Both of these have suddenly dried up, and that is what is, at least in the short term, I'm not speaking of the systemic aspects, maybe I'll say something about those systemic things as well, but in the short term, that is what is causing the kind of crisis that we face. What is that tradition of ideas? That is called modern Indian political thought. This tradition of ideas, which begins after the coming of colonialism, which has all the great thinkers that we all study about. Modern Indian political thought is the genre, is the tradition through which India negotiated modernity. These are people, modern India has not been constituted, no matter what we might wish to claim, it has not been shaped by the thoughts of Kautilya. We may teach him, we should teach him, but Kautilya is not shaping your modern Indian thought, modern India. Modern India has been shaped by this very modern tradition, which is called modern Indian political thought. And every single word is important. It's very modern. It's very specifically Indian. It is centered around politics. And it's not a tradition of philosophy. It's a tradition that is loosely called thought. This modern Indian political thought suddenly comes to an end after independence. By 1960s, you have some of the last great thinkers. I would argue, if there is some time at some stage, that people like Ram Manohar Lohia were the last great thinkers of modern Indian political thought. And by early 70s, this tradition suddenly meets an end. Modern Indian political thought is dead, suddenly. Thinking is now given over to academia. So the locus of thinking shifts from politics to the world, to the official world of the academia. And although I'm in an academic institution, but I hope it will be taken in the right spirit, this has been an unmitigated disaster. You know, trust universities with anything, but don't trust them with thinking. That's something you know, as they say, economy is too serious a matter to be left to economists. Similarly, thinking is too serious a matter to be left to academia. I've spent all my life in academia, so this is a serious matter of self-criticism. But more seriously, when political thought shifted from the world of politics to the world of political science, if I wanted to be even more specific, the tribe that I belong to, this has been a complete disaster, which is to say, serious thinking about our country almost stopped. The business of creating visions of society, the business of connecting those visions to reality, the business of mediating between competing principles, which was being done in the world of politics, no matter of which brand, I don't care, whether it was Savarkar, whether it was the Marxist tradition, whether it's a socialist tradition, it's Ambedkar Phule, it's Gandhian or whatever. They're all engaged in this very complex mediation, a very careful business of connecting the reality of this country to different visions, of spinning new visions is happening. All this suddenly comes to an end in the 1970s. And by the time we enter the 21st century, this drying up of that resource begins to show. This is what we are witnessing. So we are, in a sense, it's India without an idea of India, which is what we are witnessing right now. The second thing I mentioned was, of course, drying up of political practice. This is something we can see almost in front of our eyes. When I was young, and I don't mean to indulge in that usual talk of things were so great when I was young. I don't think things were that great, although when someone says, I've watched Mr. Yadav on television ever since I was a child, it makes me acutely conscious of my age. So I'm very conscious of this fact and of the gray hair that I'm developing. And I certainly do not mean to say things were lovely when I was young. I think much of that is just made up. Every generation has a way of, creating history in which they happen to be at the pinnacle of the golden age, which has just passed. So I don't mean to create those mythologies. But there's just one specific thing that I wanted to say. That the world of political practice has clearly changed from the world of political activists who are drawn into politics largely because of some ideology, some mission, some struggle, some movement, which is what could explain a large number of political leaders about 50 years ago. From that, we have entered a world where we are looking at political entrepreneurs. Largely, we are looking at political entrepreneurs, with some exceptions of people who accidentally may have come because of some movement or someone. One day, I was trying to think of Congress leaders, and who is the last Congress leader who came through some movement? And actually, I thought maybe Mr. A.K. Antony, you know, who came through a rather dubious movement, but a movement nevertheless. So he may be the youngest Congress politician who came through a movement. That route to entry to politics has simply stopped. And we are now looking at political entrepreneurs. And the younger generation of these political entrepreneurs who are entering politics, largely because their parents happen to be in politics, are biologically young, but they are very old in terms of the political, the structure of political interest, the structure of politics that bring with them. So politics as something which renews itself and reinvigorates itself is not happening. So what I've said so far is the following. I've said we are in some crisis and confusion, that it is rather surprising that we are there, that it may be for reasons that we have not thought, namely sudden drying up of modern Indian political thought and a certain tradition of political practice that we had inherited, that we had begun to take for granted. The question we now need to think about is, what is the way forward? How do we renew these two things? How do we renew these two streams? Allow me to say something about that. So in a sense, all that I have said so far was a preface to what I wanted to say now. And that's a real question about our present and future. I'm not into a business of doing serious historic diagnostics. And I'm sure if we sit down to do serious historic diagnostics, we would arrive at lots of other things. And as I said, I've skipped talking about the systemic things, about the nature of capitalism and how it's transformed itself, how some of the fundamental systems which were celebrated are actually the root cause of our problem. I did want to say, but let me just mention and skip over that one. I did want to say that that the four things which in 20th century we thought of as great liberating forces are actually become prisons of sorts. Democracy, which is muchly celebrated, which is muchly thought about as our liberation from all the ills and problems. But democracy itself has become a prison. Democracy in the manner in which it's practiced. Importing liberal democratic format in our conditions. In fact, all over the world, it's going through a very serious crisis. Capitalism, which was expected to unleash human potentials for entrepreneurship, is very well known, is in many ways the root cause of some of the difficulties that we face. Science, that might sound surprising, but the idea of science and pursuit of truth is itself something which has become a serious prison for human imagination. And religion, which for some persons was a way of connecting your inner self with something much higher, has become one of the most rotten ways of imprisoning human beings. But I'll not speak about those four things. We'll get distracted, and that's another half an hour. So let me come straight to the two things I wanted to draw your attention to. Namely, okay, this is where we've come. Yes, it was surprising. Maybe these are the two things because of which we are here. What can we do now? If what I've suggested has any merit, then reinvigoration must begin in both these places. Recreating, reimagining the tradition of modern Indian political thought. And reinvigorating the practice of politics. Let me say something about both of these. Reinvigorating modern Indian political thought. I do not mean to say we should go back to these thinkers only. We should pick up one of them as our key text and try and follow that. In fact, much of the problem is precisely this, that in the 21st century, we have inherited much of the utterly silly and irrelevant aspects of conflicts of modern Indian political thought. We are carrying dead wood. As I say in Hindi, hum 20vi sadi ki lash dho rahe hain. So I see lots of my friends involved in Gandhi versus Ambedkar. There are passionate debates about Gandhi versus Bhagat Singh. I couldn't care less. I don't want to spend 1 minute of my life in these debates. Because that's not my debate. I couldn't care what was the relationship between the person called M.K. Gandhi and the person called Bhimrao Ambedkar. Both of them are dead. For me, the crucial thing is, how do we bring together the intellectual and political legacy that they have left? And that is my problem. It's not the problem of Ambedkar, it's not the problem of Gandhi. We have inherited a certain intellectual ideological legacy from the 20th century. 20th century has given us these wonderful debates in this country, and India was so fortunate. The kind of intense debates that India witnessed of all these isms is one of the most fascinating conversations anywhere in the world in the 20th century. I like to believe that 20th century India and the first half of the 20th century in India and the second half of the 20th century in South Africa must have been some of the best places to live in anywhere in the world, because these were some of the most fertile places, politically the most imaginative places, that these were the most happening places, and this country happened to be one of those happening places in the world. What do we learn from that? To my mind, we have inherited this. What we have inherited from the legacy of political ideology and their conflicts now needs to be synthesized, now need to be brought together. And it cannot happen under one of these isms. We are all tempted. Many of my friends are tempted to say, this is all socialism. So we have legacy of, you know, what are those legacies that I'm talking about? I'm speaking of the egalitarian legacy, which takes many forms, Marxist, socialist, Ambedkarite, feminist. All these are various strands of egalitarian politics of the 20th century. I'm also speaking of Gandhian legacy, environmental movements. All these are intellectual legacies that are waiting to be brought together. Unfortunately, in 21st century, we have not yet come up with some way of bringing it together. And here is a suggestion. The suggestion is that the word Swaraj, I'm not advertising my political party, please. The word Swaraj, redefined appropriately, provides you with just that umbrella that you need to bring the entire legacy of the 20th century together and to integrate it. How? Because Swaraj, understood in its first version of the 20th century, is of course a very limited idea of freedom for my country. But if you actually invest more in this concept and try and understand what it does, then Swaraj is not merely freedom from someone else. It's not freedom from an external source. It's also about Swaraj. That is to say, Raj over Swa. It's not Swa ka Raj, Swa par Raj. Nothing original about what I'm saying. Mahatma Gandhi said it about 100 years ago. No one took him seriously when he said that. We have therefore a negative notion of Swaraj. We have a positive and enabling concept of Swaraj. Swaraj need not be only about this category called nation. It can be about social groups. It can be about self. If you are willing to take this broad view of Swaraj, then Swaraj actually, and of course I forgot to mention the global layer. So Swaraj is at different levels. It's global, national, societal, individual. And it is of two types, negative, positive. So you have an eightfold table, which I could put at the, you know, put there. But just imagine there is an eightfold table lying there. That table, so which says negative global Swaraj, positive global Swaraj. Negative national Swaraj, positive national Swaraj. Negative social Swaraj, positive social Swaraj. Negative individual Swaraj, positive individual Swaraj. And you would have a spectrum that stretches from global peace to moksha. That's an unusual combination. We are not used to handling all this range in one political ideology. But that's actually what we learned from 20th century India. And Swaraj 2.0, if you wish, because this lingo probably catches better. So Swaraj 1.0 is dead. Swaraj 2.0 is something we need to come up with. And that's something which accommodates the entire conflicting ideological spectrum of the 20th century and brings it under one single umbrella and provides us political direction. What about political practice? How do we reinvigorate politics? We do so by redefining politics itself. What is politics? We could say politics is about contesting elections. Of course it is. Politics is about forming governments. Of course it is. But we have heard very many other meanings of politics. We have seen struggles as politics. We have seen constructive work as politics. We have also said personal is political. Again, bring all that together. We are looking at a fivefold meaning of politics. And the tragedy of contemporary universe is that these five forms of politics have been disjointed. First type of politics is politics of state power, capturing state power, controlling state power, regulating state power, which is about electoral politics and state, which is absolutely essential, no way of undermining this. In contemporary universe, that job has been given to political parties. That's the only job they perform. And because that's the only job they perform, political parties have become election machines. They do a very limited form of politics. Second politics is politics as struggle. That we have seen in some of the finest movements. If I see Medha Patkar as a political actor of India today, as a significant political actor, because she has reshaped equations of power in this country. Politics of movements and struggle. This is a job we have given to movement walas, revolutionaries, jhola walas. This is their job. And because this becomes the only job they do, I'm afraid they also become unidimensional. They begin to look for reasons to struggle. And professionally, they are under tremendous pressure to then find reasons not to accommodate. If I have reached this far in struggle, I need to carry it further because that's the only way I survive. So it has become slightly pathological, even that one-dimensional struggle. The third thing about politics is politics as constructive work of doing, of positive alternative experiments, of transforming this country by actually doing things, by surveys, by new experiments, creating new things. This is the best of Gandhian tradition. Unfortunately, today, we have handed this business exclusively to NGOs. And because this is the only business they do, they turn into shops. They turn into enterprises, which are into taking grants, making money, more grants, just like any other enterprise. The fourth job of politics is politics as knowledge. As all of us know, ideas and knowledge shape power. And changing our notions of what is normal is the most powerful thing on universe. No president of this any country or no general secretary of that poor UN can match the power of someone who can define what it means to be beautiful. So you get up in the morning, see yourself in the mirror, and you think, something is wrong with me. Someone who can design that is the most powerful person on this universe. Or you eat the way your parents have always eaten, and you feel something is uncivil about the way I'm eating with my fingers. That's dirty. That's power. Nothing in this universe can be more powerful than that. So knowledge, creation of what is normal, what is ordinary, these are the most powerful things in this universe. Knowledge is politics. Intervening in that knowledge is political. Changing our notions of what is normal is political. Unfortunately, as I've already said, I won't rub at this point anymore, we have handed over this task to the poor universities, which are overburdened with giving degrees, conducting examinations, and meeting everyday changing circulars of the UGC and such like. So that's the university, this is the job of knowledge. And the fifth task of politics that might surprise you is inner engineering, connecting yourself with your inner self. This might surprise us because egalitarian tradition of the 20th century never taught us that. Because egalitarian tradition of the 20th century never taught us about why to be egalitarian in the first place. It has to be something about meaning of life. Unfortunately, that critical role in contemporary life has been handed over to gurus and babas, most of whom turn out to be thugs of the first order. Most of whom, not all. One has to be careful on these as well. Now, the point I'm making is, here are these five dimensions of politics. Our contemporary tragedy is that we have splintered these five dimensions and have handed it over almost on a contract to five different agencies. Integrity of politics is lost. What is required is to practice politics in an integral form, to bring back the unity of politics, a politics that can stretch from electoral and political to the politics of the inner self. You know, how do we do that is the challenge. So to my mind, just to round off what I've been trying to argue, what we face today is nothing short of an idea of the crisis of the very idea of India. What we face today is perhaps the most significant challenge to the foundational ideals of the Republic of India. Ideals which are beautifully captured in the text called the Constitution of India. This is the biggest onslaught that this country has witnessed in the last 70 years on these foundational ideas. This is not merely an accident. I see lots of persons, political analysts, political animals, debating what's happening in this country for the last 2.5 years as if what happened in 2014 was a bad accident. It is not a bad accident. This is what we were headed towards. This has only exposed some of the fundamental weaknesses that we had not attended to. The very idea of democracy, the idea of diversity, the idea of development, these three key principles which are key to the constitution of modern India. These three ideals are under challenge today. If we are serious about meeting that challenge, and at least in rooms like this, where we are not sitting to plan the next election 6 months down the line or 2 months down the line, where we can afford in rooms like this to think about the next 20 years, next 30 years, or why not, the next 100 years. If we are thinking about that, then we need to think about more fundamental challenges. Those challenges come from the shrinking of the idea of India that happens because that spring which nourished this idea of India has gone dry. It also happens because that energy which went into sustaining this India has suddenly scattered. For us, I would say in this room, while we battle temporary anxieties, while people like me, who are now more in the business of everyday political battles, they engage in these short-term battles, we do so with a somewhat extended vision, the vision of recreating, reimagining the idea of India. And once we fight temporary battles, short-term battles, with a long-term vision, we do it much more successfully. We can turn even defeats into strengths. We can lose battles and still win the war if we have that vision. I thought I would use the opportunity presented to me here today to talk about that larger vision. That is not a vision that people of my generation can fully enact. One of the wonderful discoveries I have personally had in the last 5 years of my active engagement in public life outside the academia has been a discovery that the new generation that people of my age have derided for long, hamare zamane mein to aisa hota tha, khas taur pe JNU mein to aisa hota tha, aajkal to bas, you know, I have discovered how utterly stupid this view has been. In the last 5 years, I have discovered that in this young generation, that fountain of idealism is still alive. And I don't talk abstractions. I have met hundreds of young persons who are willing to lead their life beyond their personal needs beyond their little careers and such like, I have found much more daring and risk-taking capacity than my generation had, frankly, than I personally had. I have found a willingness to question everything, which many of us did not have. So, in the last 5 years or so, I have seen with my own eyes glimpses not just of idea of India, but of makers of that future India. And that's why I thought when I meet these makers of future India, I should share something about that larger challenge that this country faces and how we can move not in any of the predictable options that are being offered to us at that crossroad, but actually firmly create a direction which is our own. Tocqueville said something beautiful in writing about American democracy. He said, we have entered a... Our modernity is taking a path which human history has never known before. Our only difficulty is that we don't know this. We keep walking as if we are walking on the road that Europe had traveled 300 or 400 years ago. The day we have the courage to speak like Tocqueville, to say, I know that I live in a universe where past has ceased to throw its shadow on future, and I have to create my own path, we would create a modernity which would be deeply modern and very desi. Thank you.
We have some time for discussion. In the interest of giving more people a chance to ask questions, we'll collect a few questions first, maybe 3-4 questions, and go forward from there. So since we are recording the discussion, just you can put the mic on, mention your name, and pose your question. Okay, Varun in the first row. Take the mobile mic.
So sir, you discussed that we are on the crossroads at present because these five basic things that you discussed, like the electoral movement, the electoral function, the movement, right, the social things, NGOs and knowledge, they have all got disintegrated, right? So, I mean, my question is like, if I look at someone, I mean, in Indian politics at present, like, the only example, I mean, which comes to me is like of Mr. Arvind Kejriwal. Like, you say, I mean, he rose through a movement, he came to elections. We also say that he has an NGO which is functioning. He also had a way to say that whatever is going on is not normal and we should do it in a different fashion, which you associate with knowledge. But still, he has created a great turmoil in Delhi. I mean, what he has created in Delhi, like, no one knows what to do. He is fighting with the left LG. He's not able to coordinate with his secretaries and everything. So, I mean, how do you analyze this situation?
Okay, question. Right. Okay.
Question is, how do you analyze this thing on your, kind of hypothesis that you proposed?
Okay. Let's respect the difference between a comment and a question in the interest of time. So, yeah. Abhijit.
Thank you, sir. I'm Abhijit, sir. Rather than taking personal examples, I would focus on theory itself and theoretical principles. You said that politics has to be reunited and it has to be integrated, the five components and the five forms. So I don't understand it or rather cannot appreciate it, because in my opinion, all these five pillars of the purported political spectrum that you are trying to point have to be disjointed and there has to be dialogue rather than unity. Therefore, the discourse has to be there, which may or may not be similar. So an NGO, a university, and the religious leaders, the clergy, may disagree with the state, the elected government. But the unity or the straitjacket, single-mindedness of all these institutions is something I think is very antithetical to the idea of democracy itself. So what do you have to say or elaborate your idea of unity in all these five pillars of political thought, sir?
Okay, we can take one or two more. Alice in the front row and Webhav on the left.
My name is Alice. So my question is regarding the role of funding in this matrix of an updated political concept of Swaraj and an integral practice of politics. And if you could answer with specific reference to this Una Chalo campaign, the campaign against caste politics, and the kind of funding model they thought of, which was subverted not really because of the impracticality of the funding model, but because of the existing power. And the Aam Aadmi Party also has a different funding model than other political parties. So where do we place funding in this concept of updated political thought and practice?
Hello sir, my name is Vaibhav. I teach here at Nalsar. Thank you for coming to the college. It's a pleasure to have you here. I have a question not exactly related to what you spoke today, but maybe you can take it as the last question. And sorry to say this, but people of my generation have actually grown seeing the cephalologist Yogendra Yadav, right? And because
I sent them an introduction, so.
Right. So, what I wanted to ask you, sir, was a very specific question on demonetization. It's an accepted fact that it has affected the impoverished section of the society most, especially those in the rural areas. But at the same time, politically, some claim that it has given some sort of a benefit to the ruling party in sense of glory. So, how do you see and how do you see it will impact the coming elections, including the elections in UP?
There was one more hand here. I am sorry, I don't know your name.
Kishore.
Yeah, please ask your question.
Hello, sir. Thank you for doing such wonderful lecture. So my specific question is, I understand what you're saying about the modern political Indian thought. So what would Yogendra Yadav's modern political Indian thought would be in political practice, politics put into practice? If you have to, list five concrete, five concrete points, how would it translate it to? So that's it.
Thanks for this opportunity. Maybe I should begin with the last one. I remember it offhand. It's good to talk about abstractions, but what does it mean in concrete terms of this politics? I claim that Swaraj could be that umbrella concept which is capacious enough to allow us to bring various ideals that were in a disjointed form under different ideologies of the 20th century. What would it mean in terms of the kind of issues that we look at? Let me come up with just two or three things, and maybe we can think about it later. One is, for example, the question of secularism. You see, secular politics need to be rethought, need to be thought afresh, because secularism has the manner in which, I mean, I almost feel like saying what I said about economists and about academia. Secularism is too important a thing to be left to secularists. They would destroy it. They almost destroyed it. And why? Because the principle of, I mean, secularism is one of the most sacred principles of our country. And I personally believe that you cannot have India which is not secular, which is to say, if we abandon secularism, India as we know it will disintegrate. So it's as critical as it is to me. But the manner in which secular politics has practiced it has brought it to the brink where secularism has become one of the most discredited ideas, because it is associated with deracinated thought, it is associated with an alien language, it is associated with, so basically seculars in this country thought we have a wonderful secular constitution, we have Supreme Court to defend it, we have written textbooks which cannot possibly oppose it, and we all speak a modern language a modern English. And they left the country to its own course. After 40, 50 years, the country struck back. Ordinary people struck back. By the time Ram Janmabhoomi movement came, we didn't know where to look because we had completely neglected it. So reinvigorating secularism, for example, is one thing that needs to be done. Second similar example would be, we are similarly running down politics of social justice aground. It hasn't reached that bad a level right now, but the manner in which egalitarians and social justice wallahs have supported reservations and the kind of systems that we have designed for that, we have brought it pretty close to that complete delegitimization that secularism has faced. Before it happens, it's time for you and me to rethink politics of social justice, to redesign institutions of social justice in a way that they can continue to have legitimacy for the next 50 years. Third, egalitarian welfarist politics, egalitarian economics, economic policies, have proven to be simply unworkable. We have all become, as I keep saying, all of us, welfarists, progressives, radicals, we want to be ministers of expenditure. We don't want to be ministers of income. So we want to say government should spend on this, government should spend on that, government should do that, etc. Where should that money be earned from is none of our business. That's a very silly division of political labor. We need to come up with, I do not think that left-wing economics needs to give up on its ideals, but it needs to come up with much more intelligent instruments to give effect to its ideals. The instruments pursued in the past have simply been unworkable, and let's concede that they were unworkable. This was wooden-headed political economic policies. So these are three illustrations of how we can begin to rethink how a capacious concept of Swaraj would invite us to rethink many of our policy conundrums that we find ourselves in. On demonetization, I'm not an economist, but I've not heard a single sensible economist say one nice thing about it. So I take it that it's a pretty silly economic policy. I'm not a student of management, but I don't have to be a student of management to see how poorly it has been managed. I mean, I just have to look at the queues. I just have to read the front pages of newspaper every day and the 63rd circular of the RBI to know how badly it's been managed. But I am a student of politics, and I know it's a very clever political move, which most opponents of the government haven't even realized even now. Mr. Modi is doing an Indira Gandhi of the 1970s. He's going to do Garibi Hatao. And what we have seen is only the first ball in this over. When the second and third deliveries are delivered, my fear is that most of Mr. Modi's opponents would not know where to look. This is what Mrs. Gandhi did. It is quite unsure whether she removed Garibi of any kind, but she did remove her entire opposition. What demonetization is basically a political move intended to do that. I'm not going to say whether the move is going to succeed or not. But let's not get bogged down in the economics and management of it. The important thing is, if any other government in this country had tried something which was as silly as this and as poorly executed as this, the regime would have come down by now. The government would have been apologizing, the Prime Minister would have been on tenterhooks, the Finance Minister would have resigned, the RBI Governor would have been kicked out. None of this has happened. Why has this not happened? That's a serious question that we need to reflect on. And to my mind, it has not happened because I think it's in a sense, the Prime Minister is setting up a dialogue with ordinary people. And the dialogue is something like this. Mitro, I'm going to... Sorry, I avoid this rhetorical flourishes. So again, just let me focus on that. The dialogue is this. Just listen to the dialogue. That's more important than the preface of it. He's saying, I'm going to torture you for the next 2 months. Because so that your children would live in peace. That's what he's saying. And the opposition is saying, he's torturing you, he's putting you to so much unease, 6 hours of standing in the queue, long queues. It has no bite. Because that's what he told you. He said, I'm going to torture you for the sake of your children. This is a very intelligent political game that's being played. I don't think most of his opponents even understand the nature of game, and such is the quality of politics, especially oppositional politics. And it is the fact that all those things have not happened, the finance minister has not resigned, RBI governor has not been kicked out, to my mind is a tribute to the bankruptcy of oppositional politics in our country. Because they do not even know where to oppose and what to oppose and how to oppose. Because they do not, or because they look like opposing, they do not look like providing an alternative. That is what we lack in our country. On the funding question, in the last instance, crowdsourcing of some sort is the only option. The trouble is that while you can do it for a movement and agitation, doing it for electoral politics is a different ball game altogether. On the question of political funding, most of us think in a completely sort of silly way. Whenever we think about political funding, everyone in this country is focused about the question of ceiling on political money. How to control black money, how to prevent someone from spending 100 crore rupees, how to prevent this black money, etc. I keep saying, not without much success, but let me have one more go at it, in the hope that I may have one or two converts. The problem in this country about political funding is not too much black money. The problem is too little white money. These are two different things. And if, I don't have the time to elaborate, but if you are really serious about addressing political funding question, yes, prevent black money, yes, do something about it. Of course, all these are nice things should be done. Please find ways of pouring white money into politics. Unless we do that, there's no point in focusing on black money issue. The real problem is not that the ceiling must be brought lower and lower and lower. That can actually become counterproductive. The real problem is that the floor is going up every time. The minimum that you need to spend in order to be visible in elections is going up with every election. Find a way of allowing that floor to be raised. You know, you have this syndrome, I don't know if it happens in this part, in North India I see that very often. You know, roads are being relaid every year. And after 10 years, the level of the road is 2 feet above the level of the house. Floor is rising. This is the problem in political funding. The floor level is going up. Please focus on controlling floor level rather than spend all your energies on bringing the ceiling down. That's the problem. On Arvind Kejriwal, I don't want to misuse this platform to indulge in some, you know, partisan political rhetoric. I would simply say, I would make two or three points. One is, I think in a sense, I would look at not so much as the person, as the phenomena. I'm interested in the phenomena, not the person. I happen to know the person, but that shouldn't matter. The success of the phenomena derives something from the fact that the phenomena brought in energy, not merely from the electoral political domain, but seemed to address 3 or 4, possibly 5. There is also Vipassana. So there are possibly there is an appearance of politics suddenly being multidimensional. What is the truth? Doesn't matter. You know, that is what gives energy. And probably the difficulties the phenomena runs into is not because it has five dimensions or two or three dimensions, but probably because that is not a very good example of the model. You know, there are ways of realizing a model. Some are good ways, some are very bad ways. And you don't judge a model by a badly created piece. That's all I would say. On the serious question, I think, that the five parts should be disjointed. That's a very fair comment. It's a very intelligent comment, because I think the five parts should be separated. There should be some separation. I do not mean to say that political institutions or parties should capture all these domains. No, that would be a very sad day when political parties capture it all. What I'm saying, and of course there has to be institutional autonomies have to be maintained, but this activity of politics must be informed by these five and must in turn influence these five. Take a very strange example. Think of the best Hindi cinema. In my generation, I'm afraid there is a generational gap here. When I think of the best of Hindi cinema, when I think of the best of Hindi songs, not just revolutionary songs, love poetry of the 20th century, it is deeply conditioned by politics. Politics of the 20th, I'm in no position to talk about Telugu popular culture, I have no idea. But my claim is that at least in that limited universe that I have some idea, politics was one of the most significant influences on love poetry of Hindi in the 20th century. Some of the finest novels on personal tragedies, personal affairs, were written by people who were deeply conditioned by politics. Politics was that unifying force which gave a vision for all of this to be integrated. The point I'm making is not that that a big brother state politics should watch all these. No, I'm saying that because politics happens to be yug dharma, and by yug dharma I mean that in every age and time, every age and place, deshakala, you have one activity which provides meaning and connectivity to everything else. During the days of Kabir and Nanak, it was that spiritual activity. In early 19th century, it could be social reform. In the age that you and I live, in the last 100 years and possibly in the next 50, and in India, I'm not speaking of Europe, I know nothing about North America. In this country that we reside in, for the last 100 years and for the next 50, politics is that activity which unites and integrates it all. It is that central activity. It's the most happening place. And therefore, that place must draw from all these five sources. If it doesn't, then it would not only disfigure politics, it will disfigure India. That is what is happening. And that is what I meant by this integration.
Okay, I think we have a few minutes, so any other questions? Most welcome. Okay, so Varun, Sarla, and okay, Shubham. You can start from here. Yeah.
Hello, sir. My name is Varun. So, since you have addressed many questions, I would rather put a concluding question, kind of a concluding question. So, you mentioned a political thinker, you were quoting him, an American thinker. So, seeing the oldest democracy of the world, America, that is almost 240 years now, and seeing us, we are like fairly new, 65 years. But a lot of political churning has taken place in our political scenario. Now, if you see America, They were largely the Republicans, and for some 20, 30 years they were the Whigs, which largely fell into the Republican scenario. And then we had the Democrats for the... We have flown all the political spectrum from the left to the right. So, seeing the future from here, like 2050 maybe, like 25 years from now, what do you see? Is India moving towards a bipolarity scenario, or do we see a multipolarity scenario with formidable alliances, something like what is happening in Germany as of now? Where do you look India in the future?
Hi sir, my name is Sadla. I apologize if it seems like I misunderstood some of your talk, but when you say that something like Swaraj is essential to create like an umbrella term and include all political ideologies, and then on the other hand you say that a way of doing that would be to necessarily assume that certain individuals are creating problems for themselves in a pathological and linear way. Like, for example, you've given the example of South Africa, and you said that it's essentially a better place to live in the 1960s because it was a creative movement. Aren't we sort of also excluding the fact that there was also a movement of discrimination and race issues that you're sort of invariably excluding by assuming they should come together as one?
So, sir, the last sentence again? Am I excluding?
So,
South Africa had apartheid. Mm-hmm. In what context are you saying that the fertile environment?
Yeah, sure.
One more person.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Shubham, and my question is slightly more directly related to the legal profession. So it's undisputed that judges wield a tremendous amount of power, and it's interesting to note how they sometimes decide to use it, either positively, for example, in the national anthem order recently.
Sometimes?
Often. Or they choose to sort of withhold from utilizing this power, such as the Section 377 judgment. Now, where do you locate the entire judiciary within this political spectrum? And what is your opinion on this new concept of PIL activism, and whether it has been a result of a vacuum in the political system?
We had Mr. Prashant Bhushan earlier. You should have come for that talk. Okay, last question from Saurabh.
So, sir, I've always grown up and seen that we are a very religious kind of country, right? So what is your take on religion with politics, especially in the light of a recent Supreme Court judgment which says that religion should be separated from politics? So do you think, what is the way forward, whether these two be separated, or you think there can be a minimum amount of reintegration and dialogue with religion? Thank you. Thanks a lot.
sure, of course.
But this will be the last question. We have to close by one, so. I'm sorry, we really have a short of time, so. Yeah.
And in any case, I'm very happy to step out and speak to anyone who wants to speak to me. That's basically why I came here.
So you talked about, that young generation. It is nice to know that they have that sense of idealism. My question is that, are we having a notion or idea of what is idealism, or are we at crossroads about the notion of idealism? Because that seems to be a great confusion. You talked about movies, something like that. So I was hearing somewhere Mr. Javed Akhtar. He says that the today's difficulty about making movies is that we don't know what is that image of a hero. Like in 50s and 60s, we have an idea that this is hero and we could create it. Today the problem is that we don't know who is a hero and he's doing all the things what the villains used to do in the earlier years. So today also, what is that idealism? So I find it quite confusing. So can you tell us that are we at crossroads about it, or do we have a notion of idealism?
Thank you. I may not have explained myself correctly on South Africa. I obviously didn't mean to say that living under apartheid regime was one of the finest things. What I meant, I should have clarified that, and I'm glad you gave me the opportunity to do so, which is that, you see, like the anti-colonial struggle in India, and I say this not as an Indian, I think anti-colonial struggle in India was one of the finest moments of 20th century world, because Indian anti-colonial struggle was not simply against the white man. It became the site for experimenting with all the future visions of universe. India happened to be a site for a few decades where some of the finest contestations about visions of future were took place. Similarly, South Africa was great, I mean, for certain decades, precisely because of its anti-apartheid struggle. That's what I meant to say. Anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa actually was not racist. It's very easy, you know, and especially in an apartheid regime, it was so easy to turn it into white versus black. But anti-apartheid struggle in South Africa did not reduce itself to that. The whites joined some of the finest, most sensitive writers, political activists who were white joined it. And one of the most beautiful moments of that comes when on bipolarity and multipolarity, look, politics in a large and diverse place is inherently, has an inherent tendency towards multiplication. So when we say, should India, or do we expect a bipolar competition in India? Is like asking, do we expect only two parties across all the countries of Europe? Obviously not. It would be very odd if France did not have its party, if Germany did not have its party. We are at least that much large. We are larger than that. We constantly keep forgetting that, how large and how diverse we are. So in that sense, political diversity is the norm. Now, there are two ways of accommodating that political diversity. That diversity can take forms of diverse political formations, a Telugu Desham, a TRS, and sort of in Congress, all kinds of parties. Or that diversity can be subsumed and respected under big umbrellas. You know, for me, these are two political forms. But the acceptance of inherent diversity is a must. You know. And those dreams of, I mean, you know, the problem in India is that we constantly keep trying to imagine that we are leading someone else's life, which we are not. So these dreams of creating in India a two-party competition like Britain is a silly dream. A, mercifully, it's no longer two-party in Britain. It couldn't have stayed so artificially for such a long time. In America, it has remained so, not because of natural tendency. Actually, it's sustained through law. And some of the most entrenched institutions have now come to forcibly prevent a natural multiplication of politics in the US. So that's an artificial thing. That's a pathology rather than being a dream. So greater opening in politics is normally a very healthy and natural thing. Which will keep redefining itself under big umbrellas like UPA, NDA. The Congress Party itself was the name of an umbrella which contained within itself so many parties. So you could have things of that kind, but that's a different matter. On judges, I do feel, and I sometimes feel people like me are also guilty of that, that we try and take too many political battles to the courts that we shouldn't. And it is in some ways a comment on our political incapacity and our political, how anemic our politics has become, that we run to the Supreme Court and we run to high courts for things that we shouldn't. I mean, I clearly am implicating myself, you know, we are currently in a petition to the Supreme Court on the question of drought. We've had a wonderful judgment. We go there every day. And the reason why I'm rushing back tomorrow is that day after tomorrow, again, we have a Supreme Court hearing of that. But in a healthy democracy, why should I take the question of drought and the state non-attending to that drought to any judiciary? It's a political executive question. Why should I not fight my battles on the streets? Courts are good, they are useful, but in the last instance, courts are not impervious to the overall public opinion. And when public opinion shifts, sooner or later, courts also shift. When there is an overall closure of your democracy, there is a closure within judiciary as well. And that's something we are witnessing. I don't need to spell it out. You must have seen what's happening in the courts. You must have seen the judgment delivered last week on the Birla Sahara case. It's an extraordinary judgment. I really wish in your classrooms you would have an occasion to study that order. An order, incidentally, which has not yet been delivered. It's a very unusual moment when an order that was passed in an open court has not yet been uploaded on the website of the Supreme Court as I speak. Something very unusual is happening in our country. So when democracy closes, judiciary cannot remain completely free from that. There are glorious moments in judiciary. You think of Justice Sinha. You think of Justice Khanna. Incidentally, both of them were not great jurists. You know, it's important to remember. Both of them were not remembered as great jurists, but they were persons of integrity and courage. Sometimes courage matters more than your intelligence. I suspect we are passing through one of those phases where in the next few years, this sheer metal is going to be tested. And from what we see in the beginning of that contestation, the signs are not so great. I'll just let it be. On idealism, whether we are, it is true, idealism is an empty box. Idealism is about pursuing. The only thing that's common between idealisms of various sorts is your capacity and willingness to go beyond your narrow self-interest. It could take many forms. It could take the form of going in Adivasi areas and engaging in revolutionary struggle. It could take the form of setting up a rural cooperative. It could take the form of going to the next slum and teaching kids. It could take the form of looking after dogs and lost pets. These are all idealisms. What idealism does is shaped, like in the case of judiciary, by overall social political climate. 50 years ago, if you were young and, I mean, you know, 100 years ago, if you were young and idealist, you jumped into the national movement. 50 years ago, if you were young and idealist, you were left. Communist or socialist, but you were left. Today, what do you do if you are young and idealist? All I'm saying at the moment is that it's not that there has been a shortage in the supply of idealism. The trouble is that we have not been able to create models of what to do with this surplus energy, which the society continues to produce just in the right quantum as it has always done. And I have personally witnessed in the last 5 years such enormous, beautiful energy which is waiting to be tapped in this country. Just a tiny example. We did that yatra during the drought this year. And I was so shaken and moved after that, that I just put this thing on my Facebook saying, during this summer vacation, do you want to do an internship in a drought-affected village? we will give you nothing. We will not even give you travel to this place. Come yourself. And of course, you'll get food in that village because there's no way you can buy food in that village. So you'll have to depend on their generosity anyway. And 550 persons responded within a week. We could not send all 550 to places because we had done it so late. 120 of them went to villages. And in the first village where they went, and these are your standard IIT, don't know NELSAR, there must be someone from NELSAR as well. All over these institutions, urban persons. And the first place they went to, they just could not stand heat and that food. And within 3 days, they had to be hospitalized. They took their drip and went back to that village. These are persons who've never stayed in a village. I don't know if I had that much of courage and energy when I was their age. So the only point I'm making is, I refuse to believe that idealism is dead. The problem is that that idealism does not find channels. And it is the problem of people like us who have failed to channelize that idealism. Finally, on religion and politics, there is that limited question of the Supreme Court verdict on which Pratap Mehta has a wonderful article. Please read it. You could imagine that I'm saying what he's saying in words which are far more eloquent and elegant than mine. In other words, the judicial ways of stipulating these ideals and saying, you know, from tomorrow we ban this thing, etc. These are gestures in the right direction. And who can possibly object to the Supreme Court of India wanting to keep communal appeals outside, out of elections? The real question is not that. So it's a good gesture. It's a gesture in the right direction. But court judgments are not just gestures. They are also operational guidelines. And as operational guidelines, what would it do? And what would be the real impact? And sometimes courts can inadvertently end up producing consequences which are counterproductive. So we need to be very careful on that. But I'm more interested in a deeper question of relationship between religion and politics. And I would quote Ram Manohar Lohia, as I said, the last great modern Indian political thinker. Please find time to read him. He's not one of those fancy thinkers, and for some reasons, largely due to the atrocious legacies that he's had, and some little not so intelligent politics that he conducted himself, his intellectual legacy has not been attended to. Lohia said, he did not talk about religion and politics, he talked about dharma and rajniti. He said, राजनीति अल्पकालिक धर्म है और धर्म दीर्घकालिक राजनीति है. I would continue to use the word dharma because religion is not a translation of dharma. These are two different things. Religion reminds me of Hindu, Muslim and so on. Politics is nothing but long-term dharma. And politics is nothing but short-term dharma. And dharma is nothing but long-term politics. It is that fusion of dharma and politics that I look to. And it is in that fusion, and that fusion that does not take place only on the streets, the fusion that takes place within my inner self, for which I re-engineer myself. It's very easy to say proletariat should give up this and that, etc., while I do not give up anything within myself. So it is that fusion of dharma and rajniti that takes place on the street, that takes place in policy documents, that takes place in textbooks, that takes place in constructive action, and in the last instance, the fusion that takes place within me that I look forward to. Thank you very much for lovely questions. As that, I'll take this 15 seconds for advertisement. My email ID is what you guess to be my email ID, which is to say yogendra.yadav@gmail.com. I do read it. I try to respond. Thank you.
And we'd also like to thank Mr. Adil Muhammad and Ms. Sharin, who've accompanied Mr. Yadav. They're associated with the Swaraj Abhiyan. Just in conclusion, I'd like to specially thank Yugal for being very persistent, sending regular reminders and making sure that Mr. Yadav comes to campus. So I think this talk would not have happened without his initiative.
Absolutely.
And it's great to see that this lecture series, where we've had people from different persuasions, some who would have actually directly objected and have had disagreements with you, have also spoken here. So our intention is to have a diverse platform of ideas where we can also learn and engage. And especially with Mr. Yadav, I think we must highlight the measured and deliberative way in which he presents his ideas. Right? So certainly there would be room for disagreement, questions and doubts, and there will be some time outside in the foyer if you want to directly interact with him. Right?